a bunch of good reasons to colonize Venus before Mars. Geoffrey Landis, 70, from Columbus, Ohio, is a NASA physicist and prolific science fiction writer, award-winning for a novel titled The City of Clouds. It's a story about David Tinkerman, a technician living on Mars who accompanies scientist Leah Hamakawa, whom he's secretly in love with, on a journey to Venus. As soon as he enters the atmosphere, Tinkerman describes what he sees. The surface of Venus is a place of crushing pressure and hellish temperature. Rise above it, though, and the pressure eases. The temperature cools. 50 kilometers above the surface, at the base of the clouds, the temperature is tropical and the pressure the same as Earth normal. 20 kilometers above that, the air is thin and polar cold. Drifting between these two levels are the 10,000 floating cities of Venus. Published 15 years ago, Landis's novel is based on rigorous scientific concepts and surely, at its release, contributed to launching alternative colonization scenarios beyond those aimed solely at the Martian surface. Sure, giving credibility to the possibility that one day there could be floating cities in Venus's atmosphere requires a huge shift in perspective. But ultimately, why not? 5 years ago, when the famous phosphine discovery story on Venus was making headlines worldwide, a funny meme started circulating on social media showing a group of astrobiologists aboard a Tesla racing full speed towards Mars, making a sharp turn towards the Venus exit. After discovering a chemical signature compatible with anaerobic life among Venus's clouds, quite a few scientists would have taken that detour in a heartbeat, convinced that the second planet in our solar system could offer more interesting research prospects than the more popular Mars. Then, the excitement from the discovery gradually faded, and phosphine ended up in the scientific trash bin of discoveries, first contested and then rejected. Venus went back to being Earth's evil twin, and most astrobiologists jumped back aboard the Tesla headed for Mars. The question now is, did they make the right choice? Should Mars really be the first destination for human exploration of the solar system? And why do some people insist that Venus, not Mars, should be at the center of our future exploration plans? Venus's atmosphere, as we know, is incredibly dense and prevents any direct observation of the planet's surface. Imposing cloud systems visible only in ultraviolet cross the Venusian skies at high speed to complete a full longitudinal rotation in just 4 days. Venus's atmosphere is also crossed by occasional electrical discharges of considerable power. On the bright side, compared to Mars, Venus's gravity is only slightly less than Earth's, while the gravitational force of Mars is just 38% of Earth's and 40% of Venus's. This means there wouldn't be the bone and muscle loss problem for Venus that would force Martian explorers into exhausting daily gym sessions, or over very long periods condemn them to form a new human species adapted to Martian gravity. On Venus, even at 60 kilometers or 37 miles altitude, gravity remains around 82-85% of Earth's. Your Venusian grandkids could come back for summer vacation without going through rehab. What's most important, especially compared to Mars, is the amount of available solar energy on Venus and the amount of radiation protection Venus provides. The amount of radiation an astronaut would be exposed to in Venus's atmosphere would be roughly the same as if they were on Earth. On Mars, unshielded astronauts would be exposed to about 0.67 millisieverts per day. That's 40 times more than on Earth. Cosmic radiation that would quickly reduce you to a frozen hot dog in the microwave on the surface, forcing you to live underground like space moles to minimize exposure. Venus instead has an atmosphere so dense it acts as a natural filter against radiation, which is indeed reduced both on the surface and higher up, to levels comparable to those found on Earth's surface. Regarding solar energy, proximity to the Sun gives Venus 40% more than we get here on Earth, and 240% more than we'd see on Mars. Solar panels on Mars receive 590 watts per square meter. On Venus, above the clouds, they receive 2600, almost 5 times as much. There's therefore an immense energy surplus in Venus's favor. It's also important to note that at minimum distance from Earth, Venus is often significantly closer than Mars, 38 million kilometers or 24 million miles, versus 55 million. Due to how Venus and Earth's orbits align over time, a crewed mission to Venus would require a total of 440 days using existing or near-future propulsion technology, 110 days outbound, 30 days on station, then 300 days return, with the possibility of aborting and starting the return journey to Earth immediately after arrival. It sounds like a long time to spend in space, and it absolutely is. But getting to Mars and back using the same propulsion technology would take at least 500 days, while a more realistic estimate tells us a mission would probably last 650 to 900 days or more due to the need to wait for favorable orbital alignment for the return journey, meaning there's no chance of aborting the mission and returning home early. Hey guys, just a moment before we continue. Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell. You'll help us to make products of even higher quality. And there's also a weather issue in Venus's favor. On Mars, dust storms last for months and end up covering the entire planet at times, including your solar panels. Imagine staying in the dark and underground for 6 months. In Venus's upper atmosphere, storms are local and easily avoidable. And the resources? On Mars, you'd have to dig to find water ice buried who knows where. On Venus, the atmosphere is a resource mine. Carbon dioxide for fuels, sulfuric acid for water, nitrogen for fertilizers. It's all there, free, floating around you. Here, these are the reasons that seem to favor exploring the Venusian environment rather than the Martian one. Then there are the reasons against, and here we really get into the heavy stuff. Venus is a planet with a poisonous atmosphere dominated by sulfuric acid and carbon dioxide, whose surface is crushed by pressure 90 times higher than Earth's. And this is one of the reasons many early Venus probes failed, corroded by acid rain caused by the reaction of sulfur dioxide and water in the atmosphere, crushed by pressure and practically melted by heat. If we want to continue making impossible comparisons between Mars and Venus' habitability, we just need to consider that probes sent to the surface of Mars have remained operational for years. The record is Opportunity, which lasted almost 15 years, while the longest-lasting Venusian probe was Venera 13, launched by the Russians in 1981, which managed to transmit data for a whole 127 minutes. What a difference! Venus's surface, to put it briefly, is a brutal, absolutely unlivable place. And if that weren't enough, there are also the winds. Saying Venus's winds are powerful is an understatement. At high altitude, they can reach speeds close to 400 kilometers per hour or 250 miles per hour, while at ground level, the perceived wind would be like a light breeze. A breeze that, however, due to atmospheric density and pressure, would hit us with the force of a bulldozer. So, we must face facts for now. Venus's surface is absolutely impractical for us, and in this category, Mars wins the comparison hands down. Game over then? No way, because this is where the surprise comes. We wouldn't go live on the surface, but above it. By pure coincidence, it was discovered that in the upper part of Venus's clouds, there's a layer where temperature and pressure are similar to Earth's. This has led some scientists to discuss the possibility of colonizing Venus's upper atmosphere, building cities designed to float at about 50 kilometers or 31 miles in altitude. As early as 2003, NASA had developed a plan for Venus colonization involving installing dirigibles in the Venusian atmosphere. However absurd the plan might seem, something not even Elon Musk's mind could take seriously, we're still within the bounds of science. Colonizing Venus's clouds could actually be much simpler than going to live among the radiation of Mars. Simply put, a balloon inflated with an atmosphere of oxygen and nitrogen would act as a lifting gas so people could live inside the envelope. Going outside would be possible even for brief moments, or minutes, wearing only an oxygen mask, though for safety reasons a sealed suit would be necessary since low levels of sulfur trioxide would damage skin with prolonged exposure. Actually, things are a bit more complicated. The entire project involves using a special vehicle called Havoc, High Altitude Venus Operational Concept. A space module that, once it reaches the planet, would be able to transform into a dirigible and station at 50 kilometers or 31 miles above the surface. In this position, Venus's atmosphere would still provide enough radiation protection to create a comfortable environment for astronauts, who would simultaneously be safe from dangerous acid clouds with atmospheric pressures and gravity comparable to Earth's, and temperatures around 30 to 50 degrees Celsius, or 86 to 122 degrees Fahrenheit. The plan is genius in its simplicity. Early missions would use enormous inflatable balloons launched folded inside space capsules. Once they enter Venus's atmosphere through aerobraking, atmospheric braking like Mars probes already do, the balloons automatically inflate using heat from the surrounding atmosphere. This isn't science fiction. The Russians already did it in 1985 with the Vega missions, releasing balloons that floated in Venus's atmosphere for 46 hours, transmitting valuable data. 40 years later, we can definitely do better. The assembly strategy is modular. First come robot balloons that test the environment and prepare docking platforms. Then inflatable habitat modules that connect like flying Lego blocks. Finally, increasingly larger structures assembled directly in the atmosphere by specialized robots. The module imagined by NASA researchers could be built today using existing technologies, though developing it would still take a couple of decades. In NASA's plans, Havoc could allow a crew to station on Venus for about a month, taking a total of 440 days for the journey, 110 to reach Venus, a month of stay, then 300 to return home. A long period, but still shorter than a Mars mission, which would require 650 to 900 days. If everything proceeded smoothly, a second mission could be sent, but this time the crew would stay in the atmosphere for 30 days. The fourth phase then envisions a one-year atmospheric stay, leading to the fifth and final phase, which contemplates permanent human settlement. Regarding the dirigible that would become the explorer's home, for robotic exploration, we're talking about a prototype about 31 meters or 102 feet in size, solar-powered and filled with helium. To house a crew as well, the idea is to set up dirigibles about 130 meters or 426 feet long. The upper part of the dirigible would be covered with more than 1,000 square meters or 10,764 square feet of solar panels, with an instrument gondola underneath and, in the crewed version, a small habitat and ascent vehicle to return to Venus orbit and then home. The project is still in the very early stages of development, and it's not certain NASA will decide to actually implement it. After all, we belong to a very curious species, but also very fickle in pursuing our dreams. We're the ones who conquered the moon on our first pioneering attempt, then threw away the toy, abandoning it for more than half a century. And we'd like to close this video with Landis's own words. You always have to start with brainstorming and then go beyond, defining technical details. But at the same time, we need to stop neglecting Venus as a target for scientific missions. Let's go back there with modern technology, explore the atmosphere and planet from pole to pole to understand what it's all about. I believe this would help us develop the same interest in Venus exploration that we have for Mars.